In this video, I will explain the great mystery of Ezekiel's temple. I am doing this in order to help shed light on why there will be a physical temple in Jerusalem after the return of Christ. This is because this seems to contradict the Christian belief that the era of man-made temples is now over. So, if God does not live in temples built by human hands, then why does the prophet Ezekiel spend 8 chapters describing the temple which people call Ezekiel's temple? As always, the Bible explains itself, and in this case, the answer is found in the mysterious book known as the Song of Solomon. The following scripture is the key that unlocks the mystery of Ezekiel's temple for us. Song of Solomon, chapter 7, verse 4, and I read, "Your neck is like an ivory tower." I will soon explain how this verse solves the mystery of Ezekiel's temple for us. Between chapters 40 and 48 of the book of Ezekiel, the prophet goes to great lengths to describe a temple to be built in Jerusalem on a very high mountain. This issue has caused severe stress among Bible-believing Christians who know that the era of man-made temples passed away when Jesus died on the cross 2,000 years ago. Therefore, if no more physical temples are required, how can Ezekiel spend close to 9 chapters giving detailed descriptions of another physical temple? As I indicated earlier, the mystery is solved by a verse from the Song of Songs, which provides the key to understanding the true meaning of Ezekiel's temple. I will quote from the Song of Solomon. Song of Songs, chapter 7, verse 4, and I read, "Your neck is like an ivory tower." The scripture describes the neck of the nation of Israel, or the church, since God considers Israel or the church as a woman. In the spiritual sense, the neck of the church or the wife of the Lord represents the throne on which the Lord Jesus sits as both high priest and king in his kingdom. A little imagination will show you that a person's neck is indeed designed like a throne, with the head representing the Lord Jesus sitting above the neck or above the throne. That is why the Bible describes the church as a woman and also as the body of Christ, with Jesus himself being the head. Such are the mysteries of the God whom we worship. 1 Corinthians 11 verse 13, and I read, "But I want you to realize that the head of every man is Christ, and the head of the woman is man, and the head of Christ is God." The description of the throne on which the Lord Jesus will sit and rule the entire world was provided for us in the second book of Kings. As you will notice, the throne was made of ivory, confirming that the neck, which looks like an ivory tower, refers to the throne of Christ, as the following scriptures indicate. 1 Kings 10 verses 18 to 20, and I read, "Then the king made a great throne, covered with ivory and overlaid with fine gold. The throne had 6 steps, and its back had a rounded top. On both sides of the seat were armrests, with a lion standing beside each of them. 12 lions stood on the 6 steps, one on either end of each step. Nothing like it had ever been made for any other kingdom. Indeed, there is no throne like the throne of Jesus Christ, who is the Lord of lords and the King of kings and the ruler of the entire universe." Song of Songs, chapter 7, verse 4, and I read, "Your neck is like an ivory tower." The two scriptures describe the glorious throne upon which our Lord Jesus will sit and judge the whole world from Jerusalem. The throne itself will be located within the new city of Jerusalem that will be rebuilt after the Great Tribulation. This will fulfill several scriptures which indicate that the throne of the Lord will be in Jerusalem. I will quote from the book of Jeremiah. Jeremiah 3 verse 17, and I read, "At that time they will call Jerusalem the throne of the Lord, and all nations will gather in Jerusalem to honor the name of the Lord. No longer will they follow the stubbornness of their evil hearts." The prophet Zechariah describes what will happen after the return of the Lord. Zechariah 14 verse 16, and I read, "Then the survivors from all the nations that have attacked Jerusalem will go up year after year to worship the King, the Lord Almighty, and to celebrate the festival of tabernacles." The book of Revelation describes the same ivory throne of the Lord Jesus as a great white throne, the one upon which the Lord Jesus will sit as he judges the dead at the end of the millennium. Revelation 20 verses 11 to 12, and I read, "Then I saw a great white throne, and him who was seated on it. The earth and the heavens fled from his presence, and there was no place for them. And I saw the dead, great and small, standing before the throne, and books were opened. Another book was opened, which is the book of life. The dead were judged according to what they had done, as recorded in the books." If you compare the scripture from the book of Kings and the book of Revelation, you will notice that both of these verses describe the throne of the Lord as a great throne. I will place the two verses side by side for ease of comparison. Revelation 20 verse 11, and I read, "Then I saw a great white throne and him who was seated on it." 1 Kings 10 verse 18, "Then the king made a great throne covered with ivory and overlaid with fine gold." During the millennium period, the world's capital city will be located in Jerusalem, with the Lord Jesus judging the whole world from the glorious throne in Jerusalem. The incredible splendor of the ivory throne was captured by the Queen of Sheba's reaction when she saw a similar throne upon which Solomon sat. The presidents of the world's nations who will visit the Lord Jesus for guidance and wisdom will also be rendered speechless when they see the throne upon which the Lord of glory will sit. Here is how the Bible describes the reaction of the Queen of Sheba when she visited the headquarters of the United Nations of those days to see King Solomon sitting on his glorious throne. 1 Kings chapter 10 verses 4 to 5, and I read, "When the Queen of Sheba saw all the wisdom of Solomon and the palace he had built, the food on his table, the sitting of his officials, the attending servants in their robes, his cupbearers, and the burnt offerings he made at the temple of the Lord, she was overwhelmed." If the Queen of Sheba, a lady who was familiar with the magnificent lives that kings lived in those days, was overwhelmed by Solomon's throne, then imagine how overwhelmed we will be when we see Jesus and his team of righteous judges sitting on the throne with him. Not only that, but imagine being among those who will serve at such a throne. All this is possible if we hold on to our faith in the Lord and refuse to follow demons and false Christ and false prophets. The following are the very words which the Queen of Sheba uttered as she gazed in shock and amazement at a replica of the very throne on which the King of Kings will sit in Jerusalem. 1 Kings 10 verses 8 to 9, and I read, "How happy your people must be. How happy your officials who continually stand before you and hear your wisdom. Praise be to the Lord your God, who has delighted in you and placed you on the throne of Israel. Because of the Lord's eternal love for Israel, he has made you king to maintain justice and righteousness." Such is the greatness of the throne of our Lord Jesus, and the joy and happiness of those who will stand before the King of Kings and drink from the well of unending wisdom. For the first time since the world was created, the whole earth will be ruled by a king whose every action will be righteous and just. The prophet Ezekiel provides details of the location of this magnificent throne. The throne of the Lord Jesus will be located right inside the city known as Ezekiel's temple, which is the new palace of the eternal King of Israel. This is what Ezekiel saw and heard. Ezekiel 43 verses 5 to 7, and I read, "Then the Spirit lifted me up and brought me into the inner court, and the glory of the Lord filled the temple. While the man was standing beside me, I heard someone speaking to me from inside the temple. He said, 'Son of man, this is the place of my throne and the place for the soles of my feet. This is where I will live among the Israelites forever. The people of Israel will never again defile my holy name.'" What this means is that the temple described in detail by Ezekiel is not a temple at all, but the palace of the Lord of glory and the seat of power of the righteous government of the Lord Jesus. This is the place from where Jesus will rule the whole world, and it is not a normal temple as we have considered it. The prophet Jeremiah prophesied long ago that God's temple, which he calls a sanctuary, will also be the place where the throne of the Lord will be found. Jeremiah 17 verse 12, and I read, "A glorious throne, exalted from the beginning, is the place of our sanctuary." The reason why Ezekiel's building is defined as a temple is because the presence of the Lord Jesus will live in this palace. And where God's presence is found, the place instantly becomes a holy temple. It is the same with our physical bodies. They are called temples of the living God because the Spirit of God dwells in us, as the following scripture explains. 1 Corinthians chapter 6 verse 19, and I read, "Do you not know that your bodies are temples of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you have received from God?" Further to that, a king's palace and God's temple have the same design, such that one can use a temple as a palace and a palace as a temple. This is why God provided detailed descriptions of Solomon's palace, so we could see its similarity and almost exact match and design with Solomon's temple. The palace and the temple have the same design. It must be noted that the reason why Old Testament kings lived in palaces and not in temples is because the office of king and the office of priest were held by two separate people in those days. What this meant was that in the palace, the king reigned supreme, but in the temple of God, the high priest was the final authority. That is why kings were not allowed to perform the duties of priests in the temple, and also why priests did not become kings. It was all for the purpose of obtaining a separation of powers so that there will be some checks and balances on both the kingdom and the priesthood. But Jesus will sit on his throne in Jerusalem as both king and priest. Since he is both the king of Israel and the high priest of the new covenant, following the priestly line of Melchizedek and not of Aaron, as the book of Hebrews explains. Hebrews 5 verses 8 to 10, and I read, "Son though he was, he learned obedience from what he suffered, and once made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation for all who obey him, and was designated by God to be high priest in the order of Melchizedek." In a prophecy about the Lord Jesus given in the book of Genesis, the Bible confirms that Jesus, the one also known as Melchizedek, is both king and priest. Genesis 14 verse 18. Then Melchizedek, king of Salem, brought out bread and wine. He was priest of God Most High. Because he is both king and priest, Jesus does not need a palace and a temple built separately as King Solomon did, because Jesus will hold two offices simultaneously. Jesus will therefore sit in his palace to rule as king, while also performing the duties of the high priest from the same palace, thereby transforming the palace into a temple. The Almighty God has already explained how this will work, so that we are not confused when Jesus performs his priestly duties from a man-made temple, the one people know as Ezekiel's temple. Such are the mysteries of our God. Zechariah 6 verses 12 to 13, and I read, "Tell him this is what the Lord Almighty says. Here is the man whose name is the branch, and he will branch out from his place and build the temple of the Lord. It is he who will build the temple of the Lord, and he will be clothed with majesty and will sit and rule on his throne. And he will be a priest on his throne, and there will be harmony between the two." We know that the Lord Jesus is the one whom Zechariah calls the branch, since he branched off from the Father and became a separate man, yet he is and always has been one with God the Father. The book of John explains this mystery. John 1 verse 18, and I read, "No one has ever seen God, but the one and only Son, who is himself God and is in closest relationship with the Father, has made him known." John 16 verse 28, and I read, "I came from the Father and entered the world. Now I am leaving the world and going back to the Father." This is Jesus speaking. The Lord Jesus is the man known as Solomon in the Song of Solomon, the one who is currently building a temple in the New Jerusalem. When the temple is completed, Jesus will come down to occupy his temple with his glorious queen, who are the resurrected saints, or the church, and his throne will be located in the physical palace known as Ezekiel's temple. This is the throne which the prophet Isaiah described as follows. Isaiah 16 verse 5, and I read, "In love a throne will be established, in faithfulness a man will sit on it, one from the house of David, one who in judging seeks justice and speeds the cause of righteousness." Just before I conclude this video, I will ask the question which I am sure someone will ask me, which is this: if Ezekiel's temple is actually a palace of the Lord Jesus after he returns, then why will burnt offerings still be made in the temple, since Christ was meant to be the final sacrifice and offering? This is a very valid question, whose answer I will give in a future video as we continue to unravel the mysteries hidden in the Song of Solomon, which is a book about the end times and not about love or romance. So stay with me on this channel so we can continue to learn and share God's amazing word.